Do you have a great idea for an app but have no idea how to actually create one? Not to worry. In this week's challenge, you'll learn to create an app without having any experience writing code. Welcome to the Week 5 Build, Measure, Learn Challenge. This week, we're going to build a media wishlist app using a no-code platform called Glide. If you're new to the weekly challenges, these are all about taking an idea for a new venture and starting small, creating a simple prototype of an online product or business that gives you a way to get immediate customer impact. In this video, I'll walk through the week number 5 challenge and provide some tips on how to approach it. Then I'll walk through an example for a business idea that I have so you can see how I do it. Be sure to stay to the end for a preview of next week's challenge. Let's get into it. The week number 5 challenge is to build an app using the free version of a no-code app building platform called Glide to create a wishlist app that stores media recommendations. This idea came to my mind when I was sharing a movie recommendation with a family member, and they immediately pulled out their phone and started typing a note in the generic notes app. They mentioned wanting to remember the film and who recommended it so they could circle back once they saw it. The goal of this weekly challenge is to learn how to build an app using a no-code platform, even if you don't know anything about writing code. If this is you, then Glide is a great place to start since it has very simple and basic tools to work with, yet it still helps you to produce a viable app that looks good and is surprisingly functional. Here are 7 simple steps to help you succeed at this challenge. Number 1, create a free account on Glide. Number 2, choose whether you want to store your wishlist recommendation data on Glide or if you want to put it into an online spreadsheet like Google Sheets or Microsoft 365. Step number 3, come up with a list of 3 favorite movies, 3 favorite songs, and 3 favorite books to get your database started. Enter this data into the table you've selected for the app, whether it's the internal tables in Glide, whether it's Google Sheets, Microsoft 365, or some other online worksheet or spreadsheet. Step number 4, drag and drop the tools in Glide to create the features of your app. And I'll show you how to do this in more detail later in this video when I walk through a demo. Step number 5, test your new app in the preview mode and make sure it's doing all the things that you want it to. Then you can publish the app. Step number 6, be sure to note that Glide does not allow you to directly publish your app into the App Store. You can run it through a web browser on your phone, and you can even create a shortcut that makes it look and operate like an app. And finally, step number 7, share the app with friends and get their feedback. Now I'm going to walk through an example build for this app using Glide. So here we are in the Glide app builder. This is meant to help anyone, even someone who doesn't know how to write code, to create an app really, really quickly and easily. There are templates that you can start with and then tailor them to your purposes. There's also AI that will help you to build apps just from a prompt. In this case, we're going to start from a blank template and then we're going to create the app from there. So I'm going to start by clicking on New App. And as you can see across the top, we can use a basic template, we can use AI, or we can use blank, which is what we'll do here. The other thing you can do is you already have data that you want to use to run your app. You can use a Google Sheet or Airtable or Excel or some other data source and actually point to the data first and then organize the app around it. In this case, I'm going to start with the app template and say create app. Now, as you can see, I have the outline of a phone, but the app doesn't actually have anything in it yet. So we're going to be able to add the tools and details and icons that we want to be able to run the app. And as you can see over on the right, you have things like the style of card you want to create, maybe a list, a table, a grid, or you can customize accordingly. When I click on the plus sign at the top, I can start to choose how I want to format this. I'm going to start with screen from data and empty table. So what this means is I'm going to have a table that I'm going to use to actually draw the data out, and it's going to actually be what stands behind what's on this particular page. Over on the right, it comes up and the label says empty table. For this, I'm going to create categories. For categories, I'm going to choose list. So this is actually going to allow me to put data in and list out what categories I'm going to choose. Once I've created a screen for categories, I can start to add some actual categories. I want to start out with movies. Then I want to add music. I'm also going to create a category for books. We can even create one for TV or streaming series. So now, as you can see, we've created 4 categories that we can use later when someone wants to choose the type of media that they're looking for. Next, I want to create a separate screen that actually allows me to input the individual data, but then associate it with these categories. So I'm going to start by creating something called things. This is just all the data elements. A thing could be a movie, it could be music, a song, it could be a book, whatever it is. But then later we'll associate those with categories. And by doing this, we're actually building the data that's going to drive the different decisions and user experience within the app. So now let's take a look at a version of the media recommendation app that I've already built so you can see how I structured it and some of the decisions I made as I was developing the app. To do that, we'll go back to the dashboard. I'm going to select my app, which is called LifeQ, Media Recommendations. And inside, you'll see exactly how I've structured this. I've created a screen to add recommendations. In this screen, the user can click on the X button and just add a new recommendation of a film. They can choose an image, they can create a description, and so forth. And that will add it to the list. And by choosing the data points, it will populate the data that will drive other aspects of the app. So things like which category it will fall into. It could be a movie, a show or series, a book or music. And when I click into these, it will show which of the series or shows or which of the movies, which of the things, as I've called them, are actually associated with that category. And so whether you're choosing books or whether you're choosing music, you'll have the opportunity to see what data is associated. Things is where I've identified the individual data points. So this is everything from a song or a show or a film or a book. So you can see along the bottom we have recommendation, categories, and things. So these are the three big areas of the app, and we can click through these and see what data actually resides here. And if we wanted to go behind the scenes and see the data tables, we can click on the data link and tab up at the top, and it'll show us all the different data points. It shows us here who is it that's recommended it, what category is it in, the image, and also the name of the item, whether it's a book or a film or a series. Likewise, we can look at the data that the categories are showing. So the category name, the related things. So these are the items that connect to those categories. So it's showing each of the films. It's showing each of the series, the books, music, and so forth. I've also created an icon or an image for each of the categories. That way, when you go into the categories part of the app, you can just click on the icon and use that to show you where to find the item you're looking for. So as you can see here back in the layout version of the app, we can see each of the categories. And again, we can click through these to see the items that fit. We can go to the menu that has all of the items. We can look at the category breakdown, so movies, shows, and series. And you can also look at the recommendations themselves. So who made this recommendation? What did they recommend? And that way you can go back and let them know that you checked it out, what you thought of it, and give them that feedback. And then ultimately, when you're ready, you can share this app and it will provide you with a downloadable QR code that you can show to individuals. You can also copy the app link. And because this is a web app, this is going to show in a web browser. And on your phone, you can actually then take any web page and turn it into a shortcut on your home screen that will look like an app. So even though Glide does not directly deploy right to the App Store, you do have the ability to make it look like an app and operate like an app. So you can actually share this app with your friends. They can make recommendations that you can see. You can make recommendations that they can see, and you can share it with others. So that gives you an idea of how I approach this project, building an app using Glide, leveraging data, and actually using it as a data collector and also an organizer of that data so that it's useful. So this is just one approach. There are lots of ways that you can go about this. And so I look forward to hearing how you've approached it. So be sure to post a note below and talk about any differences in the way that you approach this particular challenge. Once you have built your wish list app using Glide, you're ready to move to the measure stage of the process. As with previous challenges, there are many ways you could collect data to measure results related to the app. But for this one, I recommend observation. This involves asking a few people to try out the app while you're watching them use it. Here's why this can be a powerful way to gain insights about your app. First, you can immediately see what aspects of the app are intuitive for the customer versus places where they seem to get stuck or start to ask you questions. Second, if the user seems confused or frustrated, you can talk them through what they are trying to do so that you can still get input about other parts of the app. In a real setting, these kinds of problems can lead people to leave the app or abandon it altogether. Third, you might get input or ideas that can help you to improve or expand the capabilities of the app just by observing what they're doing or what they're maybe trying to do and realize that they're not able to. As always, you'll want to collect this input. You'll want to take notes and jot down questions that are asked or places where customers seem to get stuck. Also, things that you observe them do or not do that you would have expected. These are all data points that can inform future decisions about how you're going to approach the app. Now you're ready for the learn phase. This is where you will think through what it is that you've observed as customers were using the app and what kinds of questions they asked, what kind of input they gave, just things that surprised you or that you didn't expect or assumptions you had that you realized were not quite as you expected. Also things that happened that you were expecting, things that went smoothly. Once you've documented your observations and reflections from this user interaction, you can also identify next steps for improving the app. Be sure to capture these learnings in a document or a notebook so you can build on this new perspective. Oftentimes, the things that you'll see in an observation stage like this will help you to define what needs to be added to your backlog, your list of new features or changes to make. And it can also help you to prioritize the things that are in that list so that you focus on the things that are going to have the most impact for the customer experience. This is just one example of building an app using a free no-code tool. Now it's your turn. Good luck with this week's challenge. Be sure to share below what you've learned from this week number 5 challenge and other ideas you might have for apps that you could build with Glide or tools like it. If you're ready to start working ahead on the week number 6 challenge, here's a preview. The challenge will be to build a simple calculator app using the no-code platforms Adalo or JotForm. Tune in next week for more details. Keep going. We'll be right back.